The year was, if I'm remembering this story correctly, let me qualify that just in case my date's wrong before I throw a date out there here. But if I, the date was the Winter Olympics in 1980. This is one of my favorite stories from sports that I have enjoyed. My parents know I growing up, anything sports related, I liked watching the documentaries and if there was any movies that came out about it. But the 1980 Winter Olympics, back during when we still used amateurs in the United States for our Olympic teams. As some have said, you know, that was when the dream was still in the dream team. You know, nowadays we use professional athletes. But during 1980, in the middle of the Cold War with Russia, a name we're a little too familiar with today, during the Cold War with Russia, during a very hard time in our country, going through the Watergate scandal with President Nixon, you know, gas prices were expensive. Gas was rationed at the time, and our country was in a time of it really wasn't in a good way, and people had lost hope. There's a speech I've heard excerpts of from that time period when the president, in his speech, he had said that, you know, for the first time in our nation's history, over half of the people believed that the coming days were going to be worse than the past. You know, people had lost that hope. And but it was that year that our winter men's hockey team defeated the Soviets, who were the best in the world, had dominated the sport for the past 20 years, and they pulled a upset and defeated the Soviet Union. Anything we can beat the Soviet Union, and I'm a fan of. But you know, that story, you know, you think about things like that in sports. You could think about them in lots of things throughout our nation's history, and you know, the sports arena is something that always comes to my mind. But you think about the country, you know, they pulled an upset. The opposite of what should happen is what happened. It was turned upside down, so to speak. You know, the Russians, that was not expected. It was the opposite of what people thought. The things were turned upside down, you could say, from what was expected. And Pastor asked me to speak on our theme for this year, turning the world upside down. And I was just thinking about that by means of illustration, kind of a silly illustration in the grand scheme of things. But again, something that was not expected that happened, something the opposite of what happened, of what should have happened. You know, you think about times and things in your life when things have been turned upside down. You know, we've heard that statement made by people in their lives when just, you know, things are upside down. They're just, it's not what you would have expected to happen. And I was thinking about that phrase and the way it was used in the verses that Pastor picked out for us this year. Today, with the Lord's help, I just want to look at a few different things in regards to this passage of Scripture, and then in regards to my devotions and some things I've been studying lately, and just that the Lord's put on my heart, and I hope it's a blessing to you all. It's been a blessing to me, but I just want to, let's pray and ask the Lord to use His Word and hear us. We just take a few minutes and look at some of these things. Father God, I want to thank you for today. Lord, I thank you for the sunshine outside. I thank you for a country that we live in that's free. And Lord, I thank you for the freedoms that you've given to us. Lord, I thank you for our soldiers. I thank you for the men and women that have fought to keep us, to keep our nation free. Lord, I thank you for our founding fathers and the biblical principles that they have incorporated into our founding documents and into the way our nation was formed. And Lord, I know you've blessed those principles when we followed them. And Lord, I want to ask you, Lord, that as we meet here this afternoon, I just pray, God, that you would just give us each something from your word. Lord, please give me a clear mind, and Lord, what you want me to say. And I just pray that you'd bless your word. I love you, Father. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. Acts chapter 17. Turn to Acts chapter 17. And while you're turning there, just, you know, you should think about things. Things in God's economy, I was thinking about this, they are often upside down. Or you could say upside down is right side up. You know, it's things were often upside down. We were just at the Ark Encounter down in Kentucky. You know, as you think about that, and you think about the story of Noah's Ark, you think about a lot of things with that were upside down. You know, the nation, you know, their thoughts and the intents of their heart, you know, everything, their imaginations were wicked continually, the Bible says. If you turn there to, well, stay in Acts 17 while you're there, but, you know, looking at in Genesis chapter number 6, you know, the Bible says that, and you jump down here, let's see here, in verse number 7, the Bible says, "And the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast and creeping things and the fowls of the air, for it repenteth me that I have made them." You know, the world was wicked, but Noah found grace in the sight of the Lord. You know, Noah was living upside down from the world at the time. As you think about that, he was living upside down. You think about David in the Old Testament. You know, you think about David was a ruddy, I believe is the word the Bible says, a ruddy in his complexion, in his appearance, and he was the youngest, not the oldest, not the strongest. I don't think he had the appearance of a bodybuilder. He was not someone you would look at and think king, but yet he's the one that God chose. You think about Joseph. God, rather, to put Joseph in a position to save a nation, Joseph had to go through, the more I think about Joseph, the more I think that we only scratch the surface in what Scripture records than what he went through. You know, obviously God recorded what we needed to know, but Joseph, he didn't sin in any of that. And what he went through in order for him to, for God to use him to save a nation, you know, that's upside down. It's not what you would expect. You think about Abraham, where God told Abraham to go to a land that I will show you. God didn't tell him where he was going, he told him to go. Now, I don't know about you, but when I go, I like to know where I'm going, because otherwise, if I start driving, I might be going in the wrong direction. My car's engine might blow up, and if it's leaking oil, for those of you that weren't on the trip, my vehicle is leaking oil, and we had a lot of discussions about it. I think it was a good conversation starter for the men. We had a good time talking about that. But anyway, you know, Abraham was told to go. He was told to go, and God didn't tell him where. He just needed to go. And you think about these different people in the Bible, how God used them. It was in a way that was unexpected. In essence, you could say it was upside down. And as you think about that, you guys are already in Acts 17. Let me get back there here. In Acts 17, in our text here that Pastor has for us for this year, I just want to start reading here in verse number 1. The Bible says, "Now when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where was a synagogue of the Jews. And Paul, as his manner was, went in unto them, and 3 Sabbath days reasoned with them out of the Scriptures, opening and alleging that Christ must needs have suffered and risen again from the dead, and that this Jesus, whom I preach unto you, is Christ. And some of them believed and consorted with Paul and Silas, and of the devout Greeks a great multitude, and of the great multitude of the chief women, not a few. But But the Jews, which believed not, moved with envy, took unto them certain lewd fellows of the baser sort, and gathered a company, and set all the city on an uproar, and assaulted the house of Jason, and sought to bring them out to the people. And when they found them not, they drew Jason and certain brethren unto the rulers of the city, crying, "These that have turned the world upside down are come hither also, whom Jason hath received, and these all do contrary to the decrees of Caesar, saying, There is another king, one Jesus." And they troubled the people and the rulers of the city when they heard these things. You know, as we look at this, I just want to look at this quickly before we look at some things in the Old Testament. You know, you look at the Apostle Paul. I love how Pastor had said, I believe it was last week, talking about how his manner was. You know, he was expected. It was known that Paul was going to go to the synagogue and he was going to preach. You know, I was reading some things about that and how, you know, some people think that, you know, Paul always went to the synagogue first because, you know, Christ commanded to the Jew first and also to the Greek. So he would start with the Jews, and then he would move out from there as he would preach. And you know, it's interesting, just reading through there, you know, three Sabbath days. You know, you think about the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and being 3 days buried and rose again. I just, when I read three, couldn't help but think about that. But, you know, the Bible says that he, three Sabbath days, reasoned with them out of the Scriptures. He reasoned with them. And then this is what I wanted to look at here in more detail. In verse number 3, the Bible says, "Opening and alleging that Christ must needs have suffered and risen again from the dead, and that this Jesus whom I preach unto you is Christ." You know, that word opening means to open thoroughly, to open thoroughly. So, you know, Christ Paul was opening the Scriptures, and he was opening them thoroughly for three Sabbath days, reasoning with them out of the Scriptures thoroughly, examining them, and showing them how he was the Christ. But then also, you look down at that word alleging. That word alleging means to place alongside. So Paul was opening the Scriptures, and, you know, he was placing them alongside what the Messiah, what Christ had done for them, and he was comparing them and saying, "See, look, this is what Christ did. This is what the Old Testament, the law is. This is what Christ did." I think that's what he was doing the whole time. And you know, as I was looking and reading him in my devotions here recently, I've been in the book of Leviticus, and I've been trying to study through the sacrifices, and I want to just say this now. This is by no means a thorough study of the sacrifice. These are just some small snippets of truth that I would read through some commentaries on these different passages that God brought out to me for me personally, and just some different thoughts that he brought to my mind. But I was thinking about Paul. He's in the synagogue. He's reasoning with them. Well, what's he probably talking about? Well, I guarantee you he was talking about the sacrifices that they didn't need to be making anymore because of Christ now being risen from the dead, the Messiah, the one payment for their sins. And I got thinking about that. That's pretty exciting to think about the Apostle Paul. And as you think about him standing there reasoning with these people, do you think he may have been turning their worlds upside down a little bit? Everything that they had been taught was now changed. It wasn't just changed, it was fulfilled. But they didn't see it that way. They looked at it as he was just throwing away everything that they had studied, everything that they had learned, everything that they had been taught. What makes the difference between something being upside down and your eyes being open, you know, looking at it that way versus, it, you know, it's belief. Some believed, and the ones who didn't, they were turning their world upside down. But the ones who believed, that makes sense. But, you know, as we read through here, I was looking at, in my devotions, the first thing I wanted to, in the sacrifices, is you looking at the different sacrifices here, and I'm sure Paul, he was there a long time reasoning with them. So I guarantee you he covered all of these things with the the people as he was going through the scriptures. And in Leviticus chapter number 2, if you want to turn there, Leviticus chapter number 2, the first thing I wanted to look at was the meat offering. The meat offering, one of the sacrifices that they would bring to the Lord. And the meat offering, you know, one thing that the Lord brought out to me as I was studying in regards to this meat offering is in Leviticus chapter 2, down in verse number 13, the Bible says, "In every oblation of thy meat offering shalt thou season with salt. Neither shalt thou suffer the salt of the covenant of thy God to be lacking from thy meat offering. With all thine offerings thou shalt offer salt." And, you know, as I was studying on this, looking at this meat offering and doing a little bit of reading on it, that salt has always interested me. In fact, I think one Wednesday night a year ago, I preached just about salt, you know, because Christ refers to salt a lot. And you know, salt, something that I didn't know about these meat offerings. Well, first off, I didn't realize that these ones particularly they're talking about here, they had to be seasoned with salt. If they were going to be accepted by God, they had to be seasoned with salt. And it's you know, salt, the one thing about salt too that I didn't realize was that these offerings that had to be salted, the salt was provided by the temple. If you from the studying I've done, the salt was something that was provided by the temple, but yet was required for the offering. The salt had to be put on the offering, but it was something that was provided by the temple. And you, in that verse that we just read, it's called the salt of the covenant, because as men confirm their covenants with each other by eating and drinking together at all which collations salt was used, so God, by accepting his people's gifts and feasting them upon his sacrifices, supping with them and they with him, did confirm his covenant with them. And among the ancients, salt was a symbol of friendship. The salt for the sacrifice was not brought by the offerers, but was provided at the public charge as the wood was. And I was reading through that, and I got thinking, you know, kind of excited, thinking about, you know, anything that we bring to God without Christ, he does not accept. You know, I got thinking about how, just as, you know, they had to have that salt on those offerings to bring them to God. So, you know, now in the New Testament, you know, without Christ, nothing is acceptable to God. And you know, I'm sure as Paul talked with them and he reasoned with them, and I'm sure he talked to them about how Christ was what they needed. Christ was what made them acceptable to God. It wasn't their sacrifices. It wasn't for this meat offering, it wasn't the salt. It was Christ that made them acceptable. If you read in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." Isaiah 64 and verse 6. Let me just turn there quickly. Isaiah 64. In verse number 6, the Bible tells us here, Isaiah 64, verse 6, "For we are all as an unclean thing, and all our righteousnesses are as filthy rags. And we all do fade as a leaf, and our iniquities like the wind have taken us away. And there is none that calleth upon thy name, that stirreth up himself to take hold of thee. For thou hast hid thy face from us, and hast consumed us because of our iniquities." You know, nothing we can. There's nothing we can do that's acceptable to God without Jesus Christ. Having Jesus Christ as our, having that relationship with Him, having Him as our Savior, and you know, you think about, as Paul was explaining how Christ was the Messiah. He was that sacrifice that they had been waiting for to make all things right, and He was the one that could give them a right relationship with God. I dare say that turned their worlds upside down. That was opposite of what they were thinking. Also, if you turn to Leviticus chapter 3. Leviticus chapter 3, the peace offerings. The peace offerings. And as I was looking at this, I wrote in my Bible here, in regard, these peace offerings were in regards to God as a benefactor, divided between God, the priest, and the person who brought it. And these peace offerings, it was as it was divided between God, the priest, and the person offering. It was as, you know, as if they were feasting together, and peace offerings had regard to God as a benefactor to His creatures and the giver of all good things to us, and therefore these were divided between the altar, the priest, and the owner, And these were called peace offerings because in them God and His people, as it were, feast together in a token of friendship. And you know, I was thinking about that, those peace offerings, and how you know, in the Old Testament they brought those to Christ, they brought those to God to give thanks for Him, to and had that time of a feast with God. And you know, I was thinking about that, and in the New Testament, how we have fellowship with God all the time. You know, I was thinking about 1 Thessalonians in chapter number 5. In verse 16, let me turn there quickly. There's quite a few different verses in this passage here, and they're all short. If you want ones to memorize, those are good ones to start with. 1 Thessalonians chapter number 5. In verse number 16 says, "Rejoice evermore, pray without ceasing. In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you." I was thinking about that and how we have that through Christ. You know, we have a high priest that we have access to God any time. We can thank Him and praise Him at any time. We don't have to go offer a sacrifice. Christ has already been offered, and we have that direct communication with God. And I was thinking about that. I was thinking about in Leviticus chapter number 4, Leviticus chapter number 4. In Leviticus chapter number 4, let's look here at in verse number, Leviticus 4, verse 3 says, "If the priest that is anointed do sin according to the sin of the people, then let him bring for his sin which he hath sinned a young bullock without blemish unto the Lord for a sin offering." And then, you know, jump over there to verse 13. "And if the whole congregation of Israel sin through ignorance, and the thing be hid from the eyes of the assembly, and they have done somewhat against any of the commandments of the Lord concerning things which should not be done, and are guilty, when the sin which they have sinned against is known, then the congregation shall offer a young bullock for the sin, and bring him before the tabernacle of the congregation." You look over here in verse 22, "Then a ruler hath sinned and done somewhat against ignorance, against any of the commandments of the Lord his God concerning things which should not be done, and is guilty, or if his sin wherein he hath sinned come to his knowledge, he shall bring his offering a kid of the goats, a male without blemish." Then you jump down to verse 27, "If any one of the common people sin through ignorance, which he hath while he doeth somewhat against any of the commandments of the Lord concerning things which ought not to be done, and be guilty, or if his sin which he hath sinned come to his knowledge, then he shall bring his offering a kid of the goats, a female without blemish, for his sin which he hath sinned, and he shall lay his hand upon the head of the sin offering and slay the sin offering in the place of the burnt offering." You read through this and talking about if the priest sinned, if the congregation sinned, if a ruler sinned, if the common people sinned, and God gives different instructions, specific instructions for each one of those cases. If one of them sinned, and the sin offering here, I think one thing that was interesting to me in looking at this is that God required the same sacrifice for the priest as He did for the whole congregation. And I was thinking about that in regards to like my family and things, and how the Lord holds me accountable for my family. And that was something that Lord really stood out to me as when I was studying that. But I think about Paul as he's reasoning in the temple with all these people and explaining to them how Christ is come, and he is the Messiah. And I was thinking about that and the sin offering and how one, not all these different sacrifices for different leaders or rulers, but one sacrifice for all. You know, I can't, you know, Paul had to have been getting excited as he was preaching that. And as he was talking about that, Romans chapter 5 and verse number 12, Romans chapter 5 and verse number 12, Romans 5, verse number 12, the Bible says here, "Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, so death passed upon all men, for all have sinned." You know, in the New Testament, Christ just talks about sin. All have sinned. He doesn't talk about if you do this or that, this sacrifice is required. Or no, it's all have sinned. It doesn't matter, ruler or no ruler. A wealthy or poor, all have sinned. Romans 3:23, verse that I'm sure we can all quote. But Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." You know, all have sinned. And, you know, I was thinking about that and the Old Testament law for the sin offering, and then the New Testament when Christ came, Christ died once for all sin, for everybody, no exceptions. John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." And I'm glad I'm a whosoever, and you are too. And you know, President Putin is, President Joe Biden is. Everybody, anybody is a whosoever. Christ died for all. It doesn't matter position, social standing, money, none of that matters. Christ died for all. And I can't help but think, you know, Paul talked about that when he was there. I don't know, but if he was reasoning the scriptures, and this was something that was so key in the Jew's life, and I have to think he talked about these things. Looking at also here down in Leviticus chapter 5 and verse, Leviticus chapter 5 and chapter 7, chapters 5 and 7, and looking here at the trespass offering, the trespass offerings, looking at verse number 13, the Bible says, "And the priest shall make an atonement for him as touching his sin, which that he hath sinned in one of these, and it shall be forgiven him, and the remnant shall be the priest as a meat offering." Chapter number 7 of Leviticus, chapter number 7, looking here in verse number 6, verse number five, "And the priest shall burn them upon the altar for an offering made by fire unto the Lord. It is a trespass offering. Every male among the priests shall eat thereof. It shall be eaten in the holy place. It is most holy." You know, the trespass offering, it was interesting to me to think about how with the trespass offering, you know, if my understanding is correct, they didn't, the priest was the only one that got some of that meat from that offering. It was split between him and the Lord. The person bringing the offering didn't get any because he didn't have any fellowship with God. When that offering was brought, there was no fellowship. That's why the offering was being brought. And I think about that, and I think about 1 John 1:9. In the New Testament, "If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness." You know, again, Christ, in the Old Testament, they had to bring a sacrifice to pay for their sin. In the New Testament, it's already been paid for. And just that change of thinking, and that as Paul was reasoning with them, I have to believe he thought of that. Something else exciting to me down in verse number 8, the Bible says, and the priests of Leviticus 7, verse number 8, the Bible says, and the priest that offereth any man's burnt offering, even the priest shall have to himself the skin of the burnt offering which he hath offered. And, you know, I had read this in my devotions here a week or so ago, and then when we were down at the Ark, there was a place where they go through the fall of man, and they have depicted Adam and Eve there making that sacrifice and having those animal skins on for clothing. And you know, you think about that and how those from the very beginning, you know, God he offered those animals, and then that skin was given to Adam and Eve for a covering. And, you know, these priests that offered the sacrifice as a covering for the people were given the skin. And you think about that covering, and you think of how our sins are covered with the blood of Christ. I mean, that is so exciting to me. Colossians chapter number 1. I love this passage of Scripture. Colossians chapter number 1. We are just about done here, so if you need, you know, I don't want some of my kids to wake up a little cranky, so if you need a little time to wake up, now would be a good time to be doing it. Colossians chapter number 1, and verse number 19, for it pleased the Father that in him should all fullness dwell, and having made peace through the blood of his cross, by him to reconcile all things unto himself, by him I say, whether they be things in earth or things in heaven. I have underlined, having made peace through the blood. Having made peace through the blood. You think about that. We don't have to sacrifice for our sin. Our sin has already been sacrificed for if we've trusted Christ as our Savior. It's already been paid. But, you know, I'm sure Paul I bet he was jumping and shouting as he was trying to tell them and explain to them that in the temple. And, you know, going back here to Acts 17, here as we go into our final descent, buckle your seatbelts. Flight attendants, would you prepare the aisles for arrival? Acts 17, and you go down here into the verse number 6. The Bible says, and when they found them not, they drew Jason and certain brethren unto the rulers of the city, crying, these that have turned the world upside down are come hither also. And I was thinking about that. It was the unbelievers that told them that they turned the world upside down. It wasn't Paul or the other Christians that were saying that. It was the unbelievers that were saying that, because it didn't match the status quo. And as you think about that in our day and age, you know, who's the ones that are calling Christians terrorists? Or it's the unbelievers. And that the term upside down here means to properly drive out of home. That is to disturb, trouble. You know, turn upside down. And you know, Paul. I was trying to think of a good way to wrap my brain around, you know, what that really meant. And I was thinking about white water. If anyone has ever been around a river that's moving fast, you know, what is it that causes those ripples, causes that white water, causes the eddies and the fast moving portions? And, you know, it's interesting. White water is really interesting, because you got parts that move faster than others. You've got parts that move slower. You have little calm spots, and those guys that know how to read it it's amazing. But, you know, what is it that causes that disturbance? Well, it's something under the surface, or it's a big boulder that's placed in the middle of the river that the water runs into and has to figure a way around. And you know, that's what, as I was thinking about that, you know, that's what Paul, he was throwing some boulders in that river as when he was preaching. It was not what they were used to hearing. And it was something that was turning their world, upside down. But I want to, in closing here, you know, the key, I wanted to just look at quickly the key to turning your world upside down, because that's what we want to do. You know, we want to bring the gospel to people and change and allow their lives to be changed. But what is the key to doing that? Well, I was thinking about, again, through the Old Testament, the different people. I was thinking about Genesis chapter 6 and verse 22. Let's start with Noah. He's on my mind lately. Genesis chapter 6. In verse 22, the Bible says here, "Thus did Noah, according to all that God commanded him, so did he." You know, Noah obeyed God. His word, Noah, God told him something, Noah did it. He didn't question it or try to explain it away. No, he obeyed God's word. I would dare say Noah caused a great disturbance turning upside down in his day and age. He preached to lots of people. He caused a disturbance. I think about David in 1 Samuel chapter 17. 1 Samuel chapter 17. 1 Samuel chapter 17 in verse 29. 1 Samuel chapter number 17 in verse number 29. 1 Samuel 17 in verse number 29. The Bible says here, "And David said, what have I now done? Is there not a cause?" You know, I was thinking about this and the story of David and Goliath. And, you know, David, he went in there to the army of the Israelites and watching this Philistine make fun of them. And he said, "Is there not a cause?" David, like Noah, he believed God and he obeyed God. And I was just thinking about that, and I was thinking that then about Abraham in Genesis chapter 12, you know, where God tells Abraham to go to a land that I'm going to show you. And the Bible says that Abraham went. He picked up his things, he packed up, and he went. Abraham obeyed God. And look at what God did. He made of him a great nation that's still around today, that God has used throughout history. You look at Joseph, you know, the things that Joseph endured. I dare say Joseph endured them because he hung on to God's promises. He knew that God would work in his life. He knew he could trust God. And in Genesis 50, in verse 20, we see Joseph says that, you know, "You've meant this for evil, but God meant it for good." And then you read it through Paul, and you see how Paul preached. You look at just Acts 16, the Philippian jailer, when Paul and Silas are thrown in that jail, and they're singing praises to God at the middle of the night. And then when the earthquake comes and they're all loose, they don't run away. They stay there and are able to lead that Philippian jailer to the Lord. You look at all these things, and I think the thing that the Lord has hit me in between the eyes of turning the world upside down, if we're going to do that, just like these men throughout history in God's word, they simply believed God. They didn't do anything crazy. They just took God at his word. Then they did what God said. And, you know, I think in our lives, we would see so many things change, so much happen, so much growth if we would simply obey God. You know, it's not rocket science. It's simply, there's a reason Christ, and so often in Scripture you see the Christian faith tied to as simple as a little child. You know, Christ brought those children before him, and his disciples were trying to push him away, but no, he wanted them to come to him, because Christianity is simple. It's simple faith and trust in Jesus Christ. And then from, you know, just like our kids, you know, your kids, they'll believe what you tell them, especially when they're really little. You don't have to try to explain it. They just believe it. And they just obey it when they're young. Well, I shouldn't say just obey it. Not always, but you know they do a lot of times. And you know that's the way we need to be with God. It's just simply obeying what He shows us in His Word. And I think that's the thing. Thinking about the theme, that's the thing the Lord has laid on my heart. You know, Paul in this chapter, you know, those people, they told him he was turning the world upside down. He wasn't doing anything other than taking God at His word, and it was causing a disturbance. It was in a good way, in a good way. And you know, some people believed, but others didn't. But you know, if we want to do that, we need to, like Paul, just simply take God at His word. One of my, you know, it's fun to think about some of these Bible stories. And I'll close with this. And one of the ones that I have really enjoyed lately is Acts chapter 27 with the Euroquadon, the storm. You know, one of the only storms that's named in the Bible. That storm where, you know, the sailors, the seasoned sailors were scared. You know, I've heard it said, you know, that if, you know, you or I are scared, that's, you know, okay. But if the captain of the boat's scared, you know you're in trouble. And, you know, this storm, they were scared. And I can just, in my mind, I can picture them under the deck there as Paul's talking to them, and he's standing in the midst of them, and he's saying, you know, fear not, for I believe God. I can just hear him saying that in a loud voice and telling them that you guys don't need to be scared, as they're all cowering in the storm. And, you know, that's what our world needs. Today, it needs Christians that amidst fear, anxiety, you know, those are two words we've heard a lot in the last 2 years. Christians that are standing strong and are just saying, I believe God, and acting on those things that He says. And anyway, those are, this is probably more of a teaching than a preaching, but those are some thoughts that the Lord has put on my heart in recent weeks, and I think they tied in with our theme, you know. And I would, if I could leave you with a challenge, just believe God, just believe Him, believe what He says, take Him at His word, and then obey Him, and I guarantee you it'll turn the world upside down.
Appreciate that wonderful message. I believe that was a help to us. And I think about kind of exciting to think about the, you know, that's how they still, those that seek out and minister specifically to Jewish folks today, is they take them to the Old Testament and they show them and they reason with them in the scriptures and they compare Old Testament prophecy of the Messiah and the accomplished work of Jesus Christ. And even the Jews that are would say they're devout today, they have missing verses in the book of Isaiah specifically that mention the Messiah, because it is just so clear of who Jesus is. So that's how they will reach the Jews today, is taking the Old Testament. And you know, the Apostle Paul and Peter and their messages, when you read their messages, Stephen that was stoned, and their messages go from the Old Testament to the accomplished work of Jesus Christ. And what a blessing to think. That is what will turn the world upside down, the whole counsel of God's word, because the whole counsel of God's word, it points to Jesus, and it certainly is a disruptor. And I'm thankful for that. I hope it was a blessing to you. I sure appreciate that. Brother Jonathan, would you go ahead and stand? Let's take a little bit of time of invitation here. I don't know how God's worked on your heart today, but I sure would love for you to have the opportunity to do business with Him. If God has worked on your heart and helped you today, encouraged you today, I sure would love to have you have the opportunity to just yield to that which He is working with you about. And so with eyes closed and heads bowed, as Miss Holly begins to play, what's God worked in your heart about today? How's God helped you today? If a biography is wrote about your service for Christ, well, somewhere in there, maybe given by the world itself, but will somewhere in there say something about you turning the world upside down for Christ? If a history book is wrote and Green Meadow Bible Baptist Church is mentioned in it, will there be a mention of one of the accomplishments of our church is to have turned the world upside down? It might be a negative. accomplishment to the world, but certainly a right and good biblical accomplishment when the Lord's using you. There's a disruption. Brother Jonathan was talking about the rocks under the water and the river and the white waters, and I couldn't help but think about the rock. Those rocks and rivers, they'll smooth from the water, they'll erode from the water. But the rock of Christ Jesus will completely disrupt and then remain unmovable. We certainly need to get the rock to those in this world system.